My name is Takeshi Ishikawa. The title is Visualised Denial of Rebirth of the Dead in the Mortuary Process, the ritual disarticulation during the Middle German period in Japan. First of all, I should briefly outline the duration and culture of the German period in Japan. The duration of the German era was then circa 13,600 to 6 or 500 BC, and was divided into six periods in terms of type chronological system. And main subsistence was hunting, gathering, and fishing. From the early period onwards, the horticulture might be added as a supplementary, not so very small scale subsistence. From the incipient German period, sedentary life increased gradually, and since the early period onward again, use of functionally divided space within a settlement emerged, mainly in eastern part of the Japan. This functionally differentiated sedentary settlement evolved into the typical German settlement during the Middle German period, circa 3500 to 2500 Kr. BC, with the development of the sedentary life and the emergence of the typical German village, the complexity of the German society also might develop from the original like small-scale society to a more large-scale regional society. According to several studies in recent years, using ethnographic analogy with the hunter-gatherer of the northwestern coastal region of Canada, this German regional society is suggested to develop into trans-egalitarian or stratified society from the late German period. The dominant aims of the mortuary studies is the reconstruction of social ties or social organization, which were expected to be reflected in the various mortuary attributes such as body direction and spatial segment in cemetery. Mainly the discrimination of the decent group mainly in these previous studies. On the other hand, recent studies uncovered the existence of mutilated or disarticulated inhumation in the Middle and Late German period. The maturation of the dead body is estimated to be conducted in the mortuary process. In this sense, the maturation of the body might be a kind of deviant treatment of the dead. However, the skeletal sample of the German era is not analyzed a lot from this perspective. In recent several decades, this ritual disarticulation of the body is repeated in the succeeding era of Yayoi and Kohun period. So we have a very similar kind of disarticulation in mortuary context until the 7th century AD, so very long time. So to uncover the ritual long term, to uncover the ritual variation during the German era will have a critical significance for the comprehension of the long-term ritual continuity and also the transformation in Japan. So, the material. Next, material analyzed in this paper was skeletal remains found at the B area of the Kusakari site. This is a B area of the Kusakari site in Chiba Prefecture, the eastern part of the Japanese archipelago. This is a prominent and typical settlement of the Middle German period. The excavation of the area revealed whole picture of the concentric circular configuration of settlement, which was constituted by storage pits, pit dwellings, and graves, reusing discarded pit dwellings. This type of graves is formed in residential facilities, that's why they used for mortuary purpose. The dead body was inhumed in various stages of depositional process of decayed pit dwellings, from the stage of the upper structure was still preserved to the stage of the deposition of the pits. Pit dwellings advanced to a certain degree. Skeletal remains found at this site amounted to 43 of a minimum number of individuals. This sample population includes fragmented and partial human bones, so among them, relatively well-preserved remains of the 16 individuals, of which the body direction and body posture can be estimated, were analyzed in this analysis. One method to reconstruct the mortuary body treatment of the dead body was to observe the arrangement and position of the skeletal remains. The preserved state of the remains can contribute to the reconstruction of postmortem disarticulation as a type of deviant mortuary practice. However, there were various factors affecting preservation of the human body, including both bones and their interrelation during the post-depositional process. The various factors can be divided into natural and artificial agents, in addition to the each qualitative nature of individual body. In the analysis, these various post-depositional factors were excluded. The perimortem disarticulation of the dead body was estimated in terms of unusual interrelationships between bones, which deviate from anatomical relations. In addition to the bone arrangement, relative differences of persistence among joints and sequence of decaying of the corpse was an important point to discriminate intentional perimortem disarticulation from another agent, such as an accidental human disturbance or intervention of a cutting of an old grave. This point was also examined in the analysis. Another way for reconstructing the intentional disarticulation of body parts is to analyze cut marks left upon bones. However, whether cut marks were left, remained, or not was influenced by artificial and natural causes during the depositional and post-depositional process. For example, cultural manner of cutting soft tissue with carefully preventing to scrape bones is one of the such factor to influence the remaining of the, or not remaining cut mark on bones. In addition to the natural causes, pathological changes and traces of roots should be taken into consideration for discriminating cut marks. In the following analysis, these post-depositional changes upon bones were also excluded, and I try to get cut marks with a vital reaction and on hyperplasia due to pathological reason. The analysis revealed that three skeletal remains were disarticulated or just only cut. The skeletal number is this three. And they are all adult male. And this is a number 207B skeletal remains. I focused on the lower limb. Most part of the lower limb was remained in perhaps anatomical relations. But this right patella articulated this is found from the distant from the original place, right knee, but the femur and right tibia was in very articulated state, and the left side is also articulated in this way. And the cut marks are a bit unclear about this one. Cut marks left on the lateral side of right tibia. So, and next is number 509 skeletal remains. This figure, from this figure, most of the preserved body part was remained in anatomical relations. The body was placed in spine position with flexed lower rib. And on the head, pottery was attached. This is a pot. And so I didn't expect to this individual be disarticulated or something such a deviant treatment was occurred in this individual. But cut marks were observed on the skull and the neck bone. One point is on this left side of frontal bone, here and perhaps here, and here. This is an opposite side of the frontal bone. This is maybe cut marks. And this is an axis. Here is a very shallow cut marks. And next skeletal remains are number 516A skeletal remains. The photo image is not so good, so I should see this figure. Most of the preserved body part was remained in anatomical relations, but this right lower limb located in a place distant from this is right hip bone and the femur, so it's anatomically irregular position. And this is unclear, but this is left side hip bone and the femur, so articulated. This is the head of femur. This is on right side hip bone, and this is femur. So this is also articulated, and right knee is also articulated. But the location of the right side lower limb is very irregular. And the cut marks, you know, so this is a posterior surface of the ischium, and then here, this is maybe cut marks. The location is here. So, the number 516A skeletal remains. Most part of the main joint of the this individual was remained intact in terms of bone position. So only the right lower limb was disturbed, with hip and knee joints still articulating. Due to the preserved connection in the right lower limb, the disturbance was estimated to occur at some relatively a short period of time after death. In other words, the postmortem decomposition was not so advanced when the disturbance was occurred. The cut marks on left hand, probably right ischium, were consequences to disconnect sacrum and hip bones, because the posterior part of ischia, where the cut marks remained, were placed on which the piriform is located. This muscle connects sacrum and femur. The cut marks might be left when the piriform was aimed to cut off. On the number 207B skeletal remains, the right patella was found distant from the right knee joint, or the hip joint, and both sides of knee joints were not so severely disturbed. The preserved condition of the surrounding bones suggests that the disarticulation of the right patella occurred in the early stage of postmortem decay process. The medial right tibia, on which the cut marks remained, is the place on which tibia anterior covered. this muscle, and cut mark was remaining here. The bone modification were left as a consequence to cut the muscle and or other nearby ligaments and muscle. Number 509 skeletal remains. Because this remains looked like to keep the bone position in anatomical relation, perimortal disarticulation was not expected. However, the cut marks were observed on frontal bone and axis. The cut marks were left as a consequence of cutting temporaries. And then the neck from the anterior. Whether mandibular and head were disarticulated or not was not so clear due to the poor preserved condition of this part. So cutting the dead body might have an enough visual effect for the living who participate in the mortuary ritual. As seen in the number 516A skeletal remains, dismembered body part was removed from the dead body in the early stage of postmortem decay process. This kind of disarticulation might have more visual effect than just cut part of the dead. So why such treatment of the corpse with the intensive visual impression was conducted in mortuary context? I argue that problem with comparing other similar cases during the German period. The lower limb is one popular body part which suffered deviant practices. This is a lack of the right femur. And the head is another part received severe disarticulation during the middle and the late German period. The damage on lower limb might indicate the denial of walking of the dead. The injuring head may suggest the denial of the personal identity of the dead. So from these studies, disarticulations and cutting of part of the dead body seen in the skeletal remains from this Kusakari site also suggests that disarticulation may be the visualized denial of the rebirth of the dead due to the fear of death and dead spirits. So the deviant, in the case of the Middle German period, the cutting and disarticulation of the dead body was suggested to relate with the denial of rebirth of the dead. But the problem is the case analyzed is still limited in number. And the meaning of difference seen in the way and the extent of disarticulation are not yet clear. So, thank you very much.